I'm Raghav Malia from Goldman Sachs. It gives me great pleasure to introduce my friend Hooi Ling Tan, who is, in our spare time, the co-founder of Grab, I guess. You know, what is Grab? I have a short introduction of Grab, but before, we'll spend a lot of time talking about Hooi Ling and, you know, who she is. Do you want to quickly introduce the company rather than me introduce the company?
Sure. We're in China right now, and Grab actually serves, you know, the 600 million plus folks in Southeast Asia. We started the company probably about six plus, almost 7 years ago to solve a very simple problem, yet a very big, painful one back then, which is safety for taxi hails. It was a problem that I faced when I was growing up. We'll talk about that more later. But when we were able to resolve with mobile technology, a la Uber, we used to be called the Uber of Southeast Asia until we acquired them about a year ago. And since then, we've then pivoted and embarked on a much broader strategy and effort to actually innovate and make really positive changes to the rest of Southeast Asia via a super app strategy, via a platform partnership strategy that will resolve most O2O challenges today. What this means is, so we're therefore in mobility and transport, food deliveries, payments, parcel deliveries, and a lot of other platform services that we do with external partners as well.
So you met your co-founder, Anthony, while you were at HBS. How did you guys come up with the idea? You know, you took it to a couple of contests. What were you referred to, you know, your own experience growing up and not being able to get a taxi. How did all of that manifest itself into the business that it is today? What are the challenges you faced?
Where this journey started personally for me was very unintended. I grew up in Malaysia, which unfortunately back then, if you Googled world's worst taxis, your first two pages in Google will come up with Kuala Lumpur, city center of Malaysia. And that was the world I lived in. That was the world I got acquainted with, but unfortunately the world that also caused a lot of anger between me and my parents because they would never give me the freedom I wanted to go see my friends or do things I wanted to outside of the house, right? It was also the world I had to learn to be a professional in. So when I was working at McKinsey, working late hours, 11 p.m. to 3 a.m. all the time, so I had to take a taxi back because I couldn't drive. I was sleeping on a wheel. I tried. And in that situation, my parents and my mom particularly finally caved. She said, you can take the ride, but I will stay up every night tracking you. GPS didn't exist then, I was still on a Nokia or a BlackBerry, and so we played this manual tracking game every single evening. I would text her my taxi driver's license, name, specific, you know, points where I was like 15 minutes away, 5 minutes away, just got in, whatever it is, right? It was like clockwork, but at her detriment and mine as well, right? So she would be stuck in front of the front house gate, lying on the couch, falling asleep every night waiting for me. Mm-hmm. And that was the life I grew up with, and that was the life that passed by. I went on to do, you know, postgrad in HBS, and that's where I met my co-founder, Anthony. Never had any intention of solving this problem, never knew I could, never ever wanted to start a company, until I met my crazy co-founder next door, sitting next to me, where we started discussing this idea in a set of classes at this class called Building Businesses at the Base of the Pyramid. We call it Bebop. And it was the only class in HBS at that point in time that focused on how do you build sustainable businesses that weren't focused on the top 10, 20%, 1 or 2% of the income pyramid. And it was a set of really amazing cases that just inspired us to say, what can we do for our home country and our home region? Because that's where most of us in Southeast Asia come from. We're developing. A developing region. So that plus hit the fact that Anthony's family comes from the largest distributor of Nissan, Renault, and lots of other cars, we realized that we could ride the mobile technology wave. We started on that journey, taxis, Malaysia, safety. We went on to then go regional, then went on to hire vehicles. We also then did motorbike taxis.
You referred to, so Anthony was in his family business. He left his family business. You took a slightly different route. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, so part of my journey involved thankfully getting sponsored by McKinsey to go to business school. So I ended up going to McKinsey in San Francisco, and from there I also did a short stint in, actually not that short, a stint in Salesforce. intentionally to try and figure out how to learn from technology companies globally and to bring that know-how back to Southeast Asia.
And what, you know, you must be missing something working at those organizations that really called you back to grab. What was that? More sleepless nights?
No, so when I left for San Francisco and I knew Anthony and team were taking the idea forward, we both knew I had personal constraints that brought me there, financially, personally, and different ones as well. But at the same time, we also knew that I was super passionate about the idea that we had, and I was spending my time, my free time, with no financial attachments, just trying to help the team as best I could. The other thing was, because I was doing this in my spare time, I had to take holidays to come back to Southeast Asia to spend time with the team. As once I took a two-week holiday, the moment I landed, I started a five-country sprint and worked harder than I did. I told my boss in Salesforce this. They found all of this really funny, and they understood my passion, and they gave me time for it as well, right? Why I stopped all of that, uprooted myself, and went back to Malaysia, Southeast Asia, and Singapore was, at some point in time, I realized my co-founder and our team needed help. We were growing, you know, it's a dual-sided, double-edged sword. We were growing so fast. We were achieving a lot. Customers loved this. At the same time, that growth came with additional challenges, and my dear co-founder needed help. He asked me for it. My personal circumstances enabled me to finally say yes, and I moved.
So your official title is co-founder and COO, but you've called yourself something else. You've called yourself a plumber in the past, I believe. How does that all fit in?
The plumber is, firstly, at Grab, we care less about titles, more about what we do, the problems we solve. And to me, my favorite problem is to unclog, debottleneck everything that is stopping us from achieving what we believe our customers deserve. From that concept, plumber became a thing. If I step back, why is that so important, right? Ultimately, everything that we're doing needs to be aimed at doing solving problems, solving customer problems. And when you solve customer problems, in order to do that, you need to solve your team's problems as well, because that's the only way to scale. So I love spending time on internal operational stuff, tinkering at things with our people, learning, you know, what makes them tick, how can we help them grow and scale, and how can I as a leader and our leaders grow and scale for them as well.
I mean, is there a natural way that co-founders find their own sort of, you know, what one is going to do while the other does something else? I mean, between with you and Anthony, how did that happen, and sort of what is it today?
One of the first few things I recall hearing very consistently from any investors or partners we were speaking with 7 years ago was the fact that the moment you have any MBA co-founder, you devalue your company by 6-7 digits. We had two MBA co-founders. And
both of you actually finished your degrees. You didn't drop out.
And we both finished our degrees. Oh my gosh, right? All the wrong things to start with. And no technical co-founder. This is anomalous in so many different ways, but we made it work because I think what people realized that was that they saw the vision and the passion that we had. They also understood that from the actions that we took, we didn't believe we knew it all. We hopefully still have the humility to say that we know what's wrong, we know what we need to learn, we know what we need to change, and therefore, by extension, we know the team we want to build with us and grow with us for this journey. One of my broader visions is to make sure that Grab becomes an evergreen company, not just the color of our logo, but an evergreen company that no longer hinges on ourselves as co-founders. Once we can do that, that's when I think we have built something truly beautiful for the future.
Just switching gears a little bit, for the audience who may be less familiar, what is the Southeast Asia opportunity? A number of people look at Southeast Asia and they think about, you know, 600 million, 650 million people, depending on what goes into Southeast Asia. But as you approach the opportunity, what do you think of it? And what part of the pyramid are you playing in at the moment, and where do you want to play in the long term?
I pause because when I think of the opportunity, it's a slightly emotional one for me. But at the same time, engineers, so numbers matter, right? in a few years' time, Southeast Asia is going to be the fourth largest contributing region to the global economy. This is after China, of course, US, EU, and then it's going to be Southeast Asia. The reason why it's a relatively new phenomenon is because historically, it's not that companies didn't see this potential, but they had difficulty actually actualizing that potential as a region because Southeast Asia consists of 10, 11 countries, all extremely different with different governments, different cultures, different languages, oftentimes many different sub-languages within a country. Indonesia alone has 11,000 different islands, depending on who's counting. And that's the complexity of what we're trying to bring together. At the same time, there are a lot of shared common problems. Infrastructure is a challenge. We've had shared histories of you know, being conquered by different entities over time. And we also have shared Asian cultures and values. So trying to bring all of it together is not easy. And therefore, when we actually looked at this opportunity, we realized we had to look at it as a whole and that we could look at it as a whole. So extremely high growth. It's also got 600 plus million folks, most of which are in the middle, lower income components. And we also have a lot of folks who are now starting to get access to education and technology in ways we didn't before. We at Southeast Asia are kind of like where China was, I would say, about 20 years ago. We have an opportunity to leapfrog now, and hopefully in some ways leapfrog beyond where China is in some ways. It's early days for us. We see this as a responsibility as much as a, hey, this is a strategic financial plan that we believe a sustainable business can be built from, and one that we're doing because that's home for us.
And how are the, you know, when you, you know, we've obviously heard about other companies when this, when similar services were launched, they faced a fair amount of resistance from governments, regulators, taxi companies when they entered. What was your experience and how's that evolved over the last few years?
Definitely. None of it was easy. It took many years of ongoing conversations and relationships that had to be built with many different entities and players and leaders. To be honest, because we are crafting the industry at the same time, oftentimes our counterparts didn't even know who had the right to make a decision. And they had to go figure it out with our guidance as well. So what has been great is that I think our partners, both public and private, they have seen from the consistency of our actions and our intent, which come to fruition from the actions that we take and don't take, that we actually have shared visions, aspirations, and intent. What we want to do is really just help make things better for the citizens of Southeast Asia. We started with transportation, we started with mobility, but there is so much more right now. Whether it's financial inclusion, whether it's empowering micro-entrepreneurs and small entrepreneurs, whether it's just making healthcare and education better, there's so much more that we can do and that they have seen us consistently work hard towards and take action on at speed and scale. Therefore, they now trust us a lot more than we ever did. To illustrate that with numbers, right? When we first did the transition from a mobility transport focus entity, less than 1 year ago, actually only less than 1 year ago, till to date, when we've gone into food deliveries, payments, parcels, whatever else that we're in right now, the traction that we've been able to accumulate has been, in some ways, insane. What do I mean by this? From no financial wallet licenses, we now have six in all the six core markets in Southeast Asia, and we've done this in less than a year. Most of the companies take multiple years to get any one of these licenses. And the reason why we can do so is because of the pre-existing relationships, both with governments as well as local banks, who are now our strategic partners as well. Beyond that, when the Uber acquisition happened, we actually ended up taking over their Uber Eats assets. And therefore, we started investing more into the food business because it was one that we believe strongly in as well. We are now the number one player in many markets in Southeast Asia and are on track to becoming the largest player in all of our markets by the end of the year.
Right. And just talking of acquisitions, and you know, this is I think you're one of the few people who's done acquisitions at such an early stage, and a large one at that too. What were the key learnings that you, one, why did you do it? And two, you know, once you decided you were gonna do it and you actually did the deal, what are the first sort of first 100 days like?
Yep. We go through the typical build, buy, or partner thinking, except our sequence of how we think about it is usually different. We usually say, partner first, can or not? Sorry, Asian accent. If cannot partner, can we build or not? Or if we cannot build, should we acquire? Which one is better and faster? Now, we have been fortunate to be able to find many good, you know, acquisition partners that have been able to accelerate our roadmap. We do it because it just makes sense. It gets, you know, products to our customers faster at a larger scale in a better way. That's the underlying reason. Biggest learnings from this are, as always, the soft stuff. No matter what the numbers say, no matter what the Excel or PowerPoint decks say, ultimately it's the people. We've said no to many deals when we believe that the cultures aren't aligning, the vision isn't aligning, or the team's inherent ultimate goals are slightly divergent from ours and can't be aligned over time, no matter what we do. Those things make or break a deal after it's inked. And those are the things that truly, ultimately matter the most.
As you scale and as you grow, you sit at the crux of technology on one side, mm-hmm. and then in Southeast Asia, a lot of the infrastructure doesn't exist, so you're sort of building the infrastructure to digitize multiple parts of the economy all at the same time. How do you see yourself? Are you a tech company? Are you, you know, an infrastructure company? Are you a healthcare company? Are you, because you have all these other verticals, are you a financial services company? And how do you maintain that balance?
Good question, because I've never thought of putting one label on it. And I think that's why our super app strategy, as it is right now, we're putting it under one umbrella called super app, is really important. We say it's powered by our Grab platform. We are a platform company, and that platform consists of technology infrastructure, people infrastructure, and operational on-the-ground infrastructure. I remember when we first started the company, I had to go, you know, do training sessions with our drivers, our first few batches of drivers, to help teach them how to use a phone, a smartphone. They've never seen one before, never touched one before back then. Had no idea how to turn on Wi-Fi, what GPS was, and trust me, the kind of problem-solving sessions we had back then was just how do we help teach our drivers to use these basic technology that is already available. Those problems still exist. So how do we then build processes and infrastructure and operations that are based on those norms? So understanding the operational part, that on-the-ground part, the majority of our Grab headcount, employee headcount, is still operational folks. Technology is catching up, and we want to invest more into that, especially as AI is developing, and we see the future of that power of automation as well coming to play. But majority of our folks are still very focused on spending time with our customers on the ground, understanding their problems, spending time with them, helping them to take that journey of learning in as scaled a way as possible. If you were to launch Grab with just that, without technology, we would have failed. If you would have to launch Grab with just technology without the other component, we would have failed. So that's why I don't think we're a technology company per se only. I don't think we are an operational company per se only. We're a platform company with multiple dimensions.
And just as you think about risk management, you know, what sort of processes do you put in place in a company that's growing as rapidly as yours is?
As I mentioned, we started because of safety, right? So from the get-go, our entire technology operational platform was designed to help prevent issues like this. These started from as much as when we were signing up drivers, and even after the local governments actually started putting in place, you know, requirements for what kind of checks you need to do with drivers before they can sign up on your platform, we've always held a higher bar than the requirement. We've taken it on ourselves, even though we knew what the trade-offs were going to be, it was going to make our onboarding process slower, it was going to limit the number of drivers we could have, but we held firm to that belief because it was in our DNA, and it was and still is the reason why we are here as Grab serving the region, right? Now, as much as you try to prevent bad actors from getting onto a platform, there will be ways to get around it that we haven't quite figured out how to prevent yet. So we have 24/7 call centers, mm-hmm. have always had that, and we have one in each country, by the way. So we have one in Indonesia, one in Thailand, one in Philippines, because everybody speaks different languages and needs different kinds of local support. We also then work with local entities, nonprofits, on the ground, our governments as well, to help shape the future of what these requirements should be, and we're always nudging them up. So we use things like technology, and I think you're familiar with them in DD and probably in the States as well, passenger selfies, driver selfies, to verify both sides of the marketplace. We also use things like making sure all of your calls are masked, or we can track and log and all of that. And we're also already investing into AI that helps automatically detect when a ride and a driver is not quite going according to what was planned, so that we can immediately pick up a call or an app and figure out what's going on and if we actually do need to intervene or not. So those are the things that we're doing. It's a never-ending journey, and one that we're constantly reinvesting into.
That's awesome. So thank you very much.
Thank you guys for having us.
Thank you.